Hello everyone. In this session, we are going to understand about the remaining techniques to handle the data hazards. As well, we also will learn about how to handle the control hazards. Those are branch hazards. The final technique to handle the data hazards is a delayed load technique. Let us see how does it work. First of all, you need to understand that this delayed load technique is a software technique. If you can understand the previous two techniques, one is hardware interlock and the second one is operand forwarding. Both are hardware techniques because if you can have a look closer look at those techniques, hardware interlock is a hardware module which is implemented in the CPU to detect and identify the dependencies in between the instructions, right? Similarly, operand forwarding also requires some additional hardware mechanism which connects the output of the ALU to the input of the ALU. Again, special lines will be enabled. Rather, we take some separate bus system which connects the output of the ALU to the input of the ALU. There, we do require some additional hardware modules. That is the reason why those are called hardware approaches. But now this delayed load is a software approach. Understanding this delayed load is very simple. The thing is, program is needed to be compiled. We need to compile the program before it gets executed. If you want to compile the program, you require a compiler. Compiler is a software, right? So what we do is, we add some additional software modules within the compiler to detect and identify the dependencies in between instructions. That is, compiler itself. Anyhow, compiler has a set of code to compile the program. We write some additional code which detects the dependencies in between the instructions. If there are dependencies, the compiler is going to separate those instructions by a sufficient number of clock cycles. Okay, so if compiler sees that I2 and I3 are dependent, okay, what compiler can do is I2 and I3 can be separated by sufficient number of clock cycles. But one additional advantage with the delayed load is these three delayed slots can be filled up by some independent instructions. I will tell you how. For an example, I9 is an independent instruction. I10 is again another independent instruction. I11 another independent instruction. So what compiler technique delayed load does is, the program is going to get compiled and the additional module within the program, the additional code within the compiler is going to identify the dependencies in between these instructions. Okay, for an example, between I2 and I3, there is a dependency found out by the compiler as it is being compiled. Now, I2 and I3, anyhow, these need to get separated by sufficient number of clock cycles, which are equal to k minus 1. Okay. But the additional important thing that is going to be performed by this compiler is, in these delayed slots, it can insert some independent instructions. Let us say I9, I10, I11 are completely independent. You do not to execute this instruction, you don't require anything. Of course, in a program, you can find out several independent instructions. You find out a few independent instructions which can legitimately occupy the slots of the delayed ones. Okay, the delayed slots are here in between an I2 and I3. There are k-1 delayed slots. So these delayed slots can be filled up by some independent instructions. This is what delayed load is all about. Okay, so if you can actually understand, in delayed load, we don't even have a single stall cycle, right? All the stall cycles are filled up by some or the other independent instruction. So obviously, you can feel that delayed load is the best technique. But the problem is it's a software technique. There is no guarantee that every compiler is going to have the additional code which is going to identify the dependencies. We can't get the guarantee from the compiler designers. If the compiler designer doesn't add this code, then the compiler will be a normal compiler, which is not going to identify any dependencies. So we cannot rely on this. Of course, delayed load is one of the wonderful techniques, but You can't give me a guarantee that every compiler will have this additional code to detect and identify the dependencies in between the instructions, right? So that's the reason why we cannot trust this delayed load, because it is being implemented by the software designer. Our approach is a hardware approach. We are hardware designers. And there is no transparency in between hardware designer and a software designer. Both these two people are completely separate. Okay, they do not have any communication. So both people, they won't complement each other. They don't communicate with each other. That's the reason why this delayed load can never be implemented. Only operand forwarding is the best technique as far as the hardware designers are concerned.
Thank you.